Hey guys, this is Chris back on K97.5, and we're back with Bastard Bowl this week. And in honor of Bastard Bowl, we have a little drowning pool bodies.
Hey guys, it's Chris. I'm back with James from Daily News Sports Trivia and a new tie-dye t-shirt. And this is this week's Q&A for Season 6, Episode 9, Battle of the Bastards. And I'm sure we're also getting to a lot of speculation for Episode 10, The Winds of Winter, the season finale. Let's get to the questions. First off, epic. I mean, there's a lot of little things that I could nitpick about it. I mean, you know, little things that bug me, a couple inconsistent things, but
right.
I mean, it wasn't all about the action. It actually had dialogue that moved the story forward and that mattered. It wasn't just comic relief for Tyrion this time, things mm-hmm. like that. A few nitpicky things, you know, like Sansa rode off after she said, you know, Lord Bolton, you're going to die tomorrow, sleep yes. well. And then he said later, I haven't fed my hounds in 6 or 7 days, whatever. And mm-hmm. she shouldn't have known that. So little things like that. The whole Sansa, you know, a lot of arguments this week, or not arguments, but discussions about her holding the information about the veil. Well, she did the right thing because it ended up being that if she didn't, you know, it would have been Ramsay hold up in Winterfell for a siege, which wouldn't have been a bad thing for them anyway.
No.
Because they can supply themselves being outside of Winterfell. These are all northerners used to the cold. A lot of discussion about that this week, that whether she purposely sacrificed Rickon, you know, that type yeah. of stuff. So a little bit, a few things to nitpick, but other than that, man, this was totally badass. I mean, you can see where they saved the money for the budget for CGI,
sure,
especially with the dragons. I don't think anybody expected as big of a scene in Meereen as we got. With the dragons, you know, this early, where we actually see three dragons in a battle now with Dany riding Ooh, one this
that
time.
That was amazing.
So, and loved it.
I know something else you were nitpicking live when we were watching it. Zigzag! Zigzag!
Yes, I was yelling zigzag. That was another thing, too. And then you had a few people, I'm not saying on my channel necessarily, but I've seen a lot of people talking about the proper way to run from somebody shooting a bow at you. I mean,
oh,
come on.
For love
I mean,
God.
Everybody was saying zigzag because it just seems like the common sense thing to do. I mean, yeah, but I don't know.
Well, let me start you off. I want to start off with a patron from Patreon, Joe right. Gaylord.
Thank you, Joe.
Says, Chris, I'm throwing this in here for the purpose of the next Q&A. What do you think about the theory that Jaqen and Syrio are the same person and that Syrio was a faceless man all along?
Yeah, short answer, I don't think that's the case. I actually think they confirmed that Syrio died off-screen, him being the dancing master that taught Arya. But the reason this is interesting, and there may be something to it, I'm certainly not shooting it down, but Syrio was there, you didn't see him die,
right.
but Meryn Trant did live. We did see him later because Arya killed him
when
she took the face. So obviously he survived that encounter. But the other thing is, especially with Jaqen and how it ties in, is why was Jaqen in the Black Sails in the first place? He would never be caught to be put in the Black Sails, to be taken from the Black Sails to the Wall. How Arya met with Jaqen, Biter, and Rorg on the way to the Wall was odd because he should have never been in that cage in the first place. So people think that he was there for a reason, on purpose, to perhaps recruit Arya and things like that. So they think that the theory goes basically that he was there to recruit her and start her training earlier as Syrio Forel.
Okay. So. Syrio, yeah, he was too happy-go-lucky for me to see him as Jaqen or Jaqen as him. I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, I like the idea because it does, you do question, especially in the books, why Jaqen's there. He has no business being in King's Landing, especially in the dungeons of King's Landing. He's there for a reason. They don't travel around just for fun. So there is something to him being there at the right place at the right time to be taken to the Wall and allow himself essentially to be captured, put in chains, put into a cage.
Right.
And so it is odd. But I think as far as the show goes, at least, I believe they did confirm that Syrio died off screen. So unfortunately, I don't think so.
It looks like this next patron, Murph Dog, felt like you did. It said, good review, epic episode 9. Epic, but also gets into dirt, mud, gut while moving character and storyline.
Right.
Great fan payback. Hard Home Director raises bar again. Q&A. Is Sansa new Littlefinger of the North?
Yeah, essentially she's learning the game. I think that's part of it. You know, why she kept the secret about the Vale Army is because she learned from Littlefinger from a very early age, as far as when he came to the story and met her in King's Landing and started whispering in her ear the very first time when they had the tournament for Ned.
Mm-hmm.
You know, started giving her a few secrets here and there about the Hound and all that good stuff, and really started working on her early, and she's learned this game of trust no one, and that's why she said kind of to John, nobody can protect anybody. You know, she's kind of looking out for herself, and you can't blame her for all she's been through. I mean, I'm not, you know, I can understand that to a degree, but the whole thing with her and her family, I mean, she basically said Rickon is a goner, and I agree, I understand what she's saying, but John, even though she warned John not to fall into any traps, like she, but the thing is, yeah, she knew Ramsay, but she don't know his military tactics.
I was thinking that, and she acted, you know, like he was so mentally superior to John. Do you believe he was?
No, I think he's, I mean, yeah, he's a trickster and he's not honorable like John, but when you see your brother sitting there and he's running towards you and he's shooting arrows at him, he's going to take the chance and die to save his brother, where right. Sansa was just saying, essentially, he's a goner.
Yeah.
Why would he not try? I mean, yeah, the trap was for to get him in arrow range, to get John out there in the middle,
mm-hmm.
to get him in archer range. I mean, I understand that. But at the same time, do you take that chance to rescue your brother, the Lord of Winterfell right now? Assuming that they assume Bran is dead, since right. Bran is the elder child. So
I say, yeah.
Yeah, I mean, basically, she is. I mean, she's learning to become that, although I don't think she'll fully go that far, because he wants it all. He wants the power. I think she is legitimately concerned about just getting everything back as far as what's hers in Winterfell and probably end up Queen of the North, that type of thing. But
what did you think about her scolding him?
That bothered me because it's like, yeah, it's like you're don't you want my input? Okay, what should we do? I don't know.
Yeah, that's exactly what went down.
So, yeah, I mean, that would be some of the nitpicky stuff. And then when he's saying, when will we have a bigger army? You could have answered that question.
That was the opportunity.
I understand that she probably didn't know exactly if or when they would show up, but if she knew there was a possibility, she had already met with Littlefinger. He had already said, I have 10,000 men at Moat Caitlin. Now, first of all, if you want to get nitpicky, they should have known there was an army at Moat Caitlin by the way the landscape is. Ramsay should have had scouts out there. An army of 10,000 people riding by taking Moat Caitlin and holding up there would have been known by Ramsay in the first place.
Yeah, see, so if you piles of horse shit somewhere.
Right, exactly. So that's the starting point for stuff you have to kind of ignore, you know, for a show. But if there's a possibility that they show up, that changes everything. They could have delayed for another day or whatever it may be and still use the same tactic, you know, have mm-hmm. them come up from the rear and basically destroy the Boltons from behind and use those kind of tactics, not just, you know, face more. But then again, if they showed up before the fight, then they're in a position to make Ramsay the one having to concede.
Yeah.
They can sit there and say, all right, here's what we're going to do. We'll let you have the Dread Fort or whatever, but you're going to lay down your shit right now and get my brother back, or we'll destroy you, because Ramsay would no longer have the advantage. He bet everything on his larger army. You know, that was it. And that's why he came out of the walls of Winterfell anyway. Because a normal, regular military commander would have never left Winterfell. They would have stayed right there and let them attack Winterfell, and they'd have been slaughtered.
But well, he wants clearly, to do things his way. He wasn't the kind of guy who was going to go out on his shield. He ran back to Winterfell, right?
Right. And yeah. As soon as everything turned,
so
as far
if
as the tide turned.
So he seen that huge army sitting over there, I'm sure he would have given up.
Yeah, I mean,
like,
yeah,
going
I mean,
down the fight.
There's no telling how he operates, but he's going to do things his way, which is why he was out in the field in the first place. The smart thing to do, anybody else, a Tywin Lannister, you know, any hardened military commander with experience, they're not going to come out of the walls of Winterfell. That's why it's a holdfast.
Yeah.
You stay in the walls and make somebody siege you, and you can slaughter them from above with arrows and rocks and wool and tar and all that good stuff, so... He did it his way just to show power or whatever, or just whatever the hell reason, basically for the plot. It was a plot device. But it worked. It worked because he did have the overwhelming odds, you know, in his favor. So I think that's what it boils down to.
Next question from Mona Thom. Q&A. Just wondering, do you think we'll see Jorah again? And if so, how do you think he'd reappear and could affect any current storylines?
I do think we'll see Jorah again. I don't know about this season in episode 10, but I do think, I don't think they're just going to let him ride off into the sunset quite like that. I mean, they could, because you could just assume him dead or whatever. Mm-hmm. But I think that he'll probably go. I mean, she ordered him to get a cure. So I'm thinking that he goes to Quaithe. And, you know, she possibly, she's a shadow binder, you know, okay. So she possibly could heal him. If there's anybody with know how, it would be her, or possibly a red priest or priestess. And I'd kind of mentioned this before in a similar question a couple weeks back. In the books, a character called Makoro heals Victarion's hand, and it looks all burned and stuff, but it saves his life because an infection would have happened and all this kind of stuff. So a red priestess or priest could potentially heal Jorah of his grayscale, and, you know, just on his arm so far. So I think he may get healed. We do know that it can be healed, but it's usually only in children through Shireen. But we don't know how exactly that happened, because Stannis just said he had every healer and maester come in from all over the world. So nobody knows exactly what did it, and whether it was a combination of things or one person. So nobody knows the secret.
Yeah. Right?
Nobody knows the recipe. So I think he will show back up, and I don't know if he gets healed or not. If he does, that would be my guess on how he would get healed. But I think he'll come back, and if he does go out, he'll go out one more time for his queen in some way, shape, or form, as far as, you know, one more act of love, right?
Well, that scene goes out. One of the first times I'd watched the show with you.
Right.
Okay. I personally got the feeling like she sent him to go get a cure, kind of like leading him on as to when you come back, we can be together or something. Was I picking up the wrong vibes?
Not be together as in romantic, but be my hand or my right-hand man like you've always
been.
She
didn't want to lose him as that.
Right, because she was basically saying, I command you, go get cured, and when you come back to me, I'll need you in the Seven Kingdoms. I need you, go get cured. But I don't think romantically.
You think he heard romance?
No, I mean, he loves her regardless.
I know. He'll die for her. Early where I'm at.
He's Captain Friendzone is his nickname.
Okay.
Yeah, I think he's finally accepted that, but
he's definitely in the
friend zone. I tell you what I'd like to see, though. I mean, if it would happen to be this season, episode 10, you know, if there's something up with Dario, which I think Dario is going to be left behind. I think that scene in the preview where Danny and Dario were talking, she was all like, you know, rubbing his face and all that stuff. I think he's going to stay behind to kind of hold Meereen while she's going to the Westeros. I'm assuming that's going to happen. Or there's some reveal that he is the Harpy and maybe Jorah takes care of him. Because there was a little, could have been foreshadowing for that when Jorah and Dario were riding along looking for Dany and they find her ring. Mm-hmm. And then he says, when I'm an old man, and Jorah says, if you live to be an old man. So if there's something up with him, I would like to see Jorah be the one to kill him, saving Danny in some way or something. So,
okay.
We'll see.
All right. Next question comes from MCCO917.
The official smokescreen commentator.
I've seen this picture and username before. Q&A. How do you think the Ironborn will react to Asha telling them that they're going to have to start making driftwood sculptures and seashell lampshades to sell on the mainland?
Yeah. This brings into question whether Yara or Asha in the books is going to betray Danny, because you're talking about, it's kind of going back to that thing again with Danny changing the Dothraki culture. I mean, something, it's wrong, you know, the things they do, mm-hmm. slavery and all that stuff. But it's something that's been going on for thousands of years, and she's coming in saying, nope, that's over. You know,
right.
you know, die in your old ways or live in my new one. So it's kind of one of those things where, yeah, the Ironborn, they're pirates. That's their lifestyle. Their whole statement is, we do not sow, their house words. And their whole thing is about paying the iron price, you know, taking what's yours instead of buying it with gold. I mean, that's mm-hmm. their whole culture.
That's what you said.
Yeah, I mean, it could potentially be an issue. I mean, in the show, I don't know how they'll do that any different, but, you know, Euron's a much bigger storyline with another brother in the book, so that could go a whole different way. So, yeah, I mean, I don't know if that's going to be as smooth as it seems it's going to be with. Yeah, we're partners now. We're just going to go back, and you let me be queen of the Iron Islands, and we'll just stop our reaving ways. So I don't see that going as smoothly as we think.
I don't either, and I was thinking that the whole time.
But then again, in the show, they are making Euron the antagonist and Yara and Theon the protagonist in that situation. So, I mean, maybe they do change. But this is about change. So, I mean, maybe they do realize, you know what, you know, it's pretty fucked up that we go raid fishing villages and steal shit from people and kill people and take their stuff. So, I mean, this whole show is about change. And I would say even going beyond that would be, we started off with a bunch of kings, you know, the War of the Five Kings, and now we're seeing more queens, I think, is going to show up. You know, you got Dany coming over, potentially Sansa in the north. Now Yara is queen of the Iron Islands. So now we're going to have, like, this, you know, five queen thing perhaps.
Mm-hmm.
And maybe seven independent states again, you know, because she's already basically said, can we be an independent state? And she said, yeah, as long as you help me take back the rest of them.
That's
you
true.
Can be queen of the Iron Islands. So now she's going to be queen, Dany, if she succeeds, queen of the Six Kingdoms.
Yes.
And Yara's going to have her own thing. So I see it possibly going to a state-style system, a democracy even, where they each have their individual regions and their own rules and laws, but Dany maybe sits in King's Landing with the federal-style, you know what I'm saying, laws.
I totally can see that.
So I see change coming as far as these old ways, so I think that's kind of leading into that. Whole idea that George R. R. Martin has.
Well, this question kind of plays off of that Sansa Littlefinger thing. This says, it's from Jester Alano. Q&A, what do you think of the dark Sansa theory? Basically, she just let everybody die before she saves the day and becomes the Queen of the North.
Yeah, I mean, this is what I've been referring to her as, Darth Sansa, you know, for the last few months or almost a year now. Where we're supposed to see her emerge, you know, last season is more of this, you know, darker character where she's learning to hold her own and play the game under Littlefinger's tutelage. And now we're finally seeing a little bit of that this year. So I think she'll get to that. My idea of it is she'll get to a point where she's realized she's gone too far, if that makes any sense. Like, she's starting to play this game and get in to be like a Littlefinger of the North, like somebody just asked. But then she'll realize, wait a minute, I can't be like him. Family is first and all that kind of stuff, and then probably end up being the one responsible for killing him.
Uh-huh.
So that's the way I see it going, where she's on this arc where she goes a little bit dark down this dark path, kind of like Arya, but then kind of bounces back from it. So, I mean, that's what I see going on right now.
Now, again, you read the books prior to watching the show?
A little bit of both.
Okay.
I'd read some before the show and didn't realize what I was reading as far as the whole, before there was, you know, five books total, mm-hmm. and seven planned, so back a long, long time ago. Then got into the show and then went back to the books again. So.
Okay, well, the Sansa that I see, you know, she's so prim and proper.
Yes.
Right now. And it's like Littlefinger is just in the picture as far as, you know, getting in her ear a little bit. I'm shocked from the Sansa I see on screen in season 3 now to the Sansa I see
right
now in season 6, at the end of season 6.
But the thing is about that,
did you
though,
see her character
that you
getting
you really
that?
You really didn't, though. That's the thing. Only now in season 6 is she really any different.
Okay.
You saw a little bit of it, a hint of it in season 5, but that was such a big disappointment to a lot of show watchers, is because you thought, I mean, this, you could see this is where it was going, but she never got there. Like, she would step up and say something bold to somebody, but then she'd be right back to, oh, Joffrey's my king, and blah, blah, blah. You know, kind of this weak Sansa. So you knew that's where it was going, but you really didn't see that very often, and it ended up being like she was just always in the same character in a different place. And now this year, you're finally seeing a little bit of this change, and it's good for storytelling, but, you know, like I said, it could go to a dark place for a little while for her. Because cool. This seemed, I'm not saying that she purposely had, you know, let Rickon die and all that stuff.
Right.
She couldn't have known exactly what was going to happen. She did warn Jon about Ramsay, but she wouldn't have known about specific traps and military, you know, strategy and all that kind of stuff, so it was just an odd thing. It was very much like Littlefinger for her to withhold information, because she's learning that information is a key, and that's what it boils down to. So,
okay. Next question from Jate Velo. Q&A, with a low estimate of at least 6,000 dead soldiers in the battle, will they be able to burn all those bodies in time? Nobody ever talks about what they do with all the bodies after a battle.
That's right. That's the thing of war. It's a nasty, dirty hell, you know, that, that these people are in, and they tried to portray that. And as far as the bodies being burned, I don't know if they're that far north for it to matter. We only see right now is that beyond the wall they need to be burned. But we did get two Night's Watchmen, Benjen's partners that originally rode out and got lost in season one. Ghost found his hand, then they found the bodies and pulled them back in to Castle Black, which was beyond the wall, and they did turn later go attack Lord Commander Mormont, and that's when Jon saved him and burned his hand.
Oh, shit.
So they did turn south of the wall, but the question is, how does that work? We don't know. I mean, did they just, you know, were they already in the process of turning when they pulled their bodies through?
Right.
And then once they were through, does the wall's magical ward only affect the wall itself? So in other words, if you could kill somebody, right, north of the wall, take them where the process starts, the magic takes hold of White Walkers or however it works, and then pull them through before they reanimate, would they still reanimate? It looks like they would because it happened at Castle Black. But if you don't die north of the wall, I don't think you would.
But is the wall a mystical barrier instead of just a physical barrier?
It's supposed to have some magical warding,
okay.
Yes. And yes, there's a couple things in the books about that hints at it. And as a matter of fact, Cold Hands in the books cannot pass through the wall. He tells you that straight
no
up.
Oh, shit.
So he helps out Bran and them, but he can't pass through the wall. So that's something that's basically hinted at.
Otherwise, those 6,000 he's talking about, he could snap his fingers and...
Yeah, I mean, you think about it. I mean, that wall, if it's just a physical barrier of ice, that's what they manipulate. That's what they control. They can just... He can apparently just touch the ground and crack the thing in half and bring it down, which may happen, by the way.
Right.
So it has to have some kind of spell on it, just like the cave did.
That makes sense.
So, and we'll see now if Rand being marked, if they still remember that was in the show.
Yes.
If he goes through the wall going south with Benjen, or even, I don't think Benjen's going, if Benjen's playing Cold Hands, which he is in the show,
he's not going to be able to go.
He shouldn't be able to pass, unless the children saving him change that. But if it is, again, in the books, Cold Hands cannot go through the wall.
Okay.
So he is a
white. That's the Benjen to watch for.
You're right. So we'll see what they do in the show. So.
Next question, Hugo Pyres. It says, Q&A, hey Chris, first of all, thanks a lot for entertaining me with your awesome videos.
Thanks, sir.
What will Peter Baelish's next move be? What's stopping him from taking over Winterfell? I remember an episode in which Lord Varys tells Lady Olenna he, talking about Peter Baelish, would see this country burn if he could be King of the Ashes.
Yeah, I mean, right now, there's nothing he can do about Winterfell because you do have... Starks there, and you do have houses that support the Starks. In the books, obviously, there's a lot more houses. So right now, the only option he has is marriage. He's essentially control of the Vale through Robin until Robin comes of age,
okay.
Because he was married to Lysa Arryn, and so he's, and then through Sansa, if he tries to marry her himself, or perhaps marry her to Robin, he could gain control that way and essentially become, you know, Warden of the North, Lord of Winterfell through Sansa in some way. So I think that's his plan. That's the only thing he can do.
Okay, so that's your answer to his question.
Yeah.
You think his plan is to try to marry her?
Yeah, I think it's a marriage. I think, and I said in that little preview video I threw up at the last minute, you know, it's a marriage proposal, and that's either him and Sansa directly, or possibly Sansa and Sweet Robin, or Little Shit Robin, as I call him.
That little bastard that was breastfeeding the one I saw?
That little bastard.
Oh, I hated him.
Yeah, I mean, he's a little older now, you know, from the first time you saw him in, okay. In season two. But, yeah, I mean, he's just, he plays him like a puppet.
That's a hell of a thing to say. He would see this country burn if he could be the King of the Ashes. That's awesome.
And it's true. And remember, Littlefinger's game, as he said before, I'm not going to fight them. I'm going to fuck them. You know, that's his game. He knows all this, you know, the political maneuvering.
Yeah.
Not going to pick up a sword.
Right.
And do it by force unless he's using somebody else's forces like he is right now at the Vale. And he's only helped out Sansa because he needs something from her. So.
All right. Davos Seaworth says, Q&A, do you think we'll see Sam and Old Town in episode 10?
I think we will. This is going to be, I believe, the longest episode ever. I think it's 69 minutes long, something like that.
Oh, that's exciting.
So, or maybe, Yeah, I believe that's right. Something like that. So anyway, there's a lot of little thing, a lot of things to wrap up. And I'm assuming since we saw Sam take Hartsbane, you know, obviously his father's going to be pissed off about it. Randall Tarley's not a guy that's going to take that lightly.
Right.
So does he go to the Citadel now and find some protection there and somehow find Gilly a way in? I would say he's still got his eyes on the bigger picture because he is going to help John, you know, learn more information about the White Walkers. That's when he went in the first place, to become a maester, to learn more about the White Walkers because they know what's coming. So he's one of the few characters down now in the mainland that knows the true threat.
Yeah.
So I think he does still go to the Citadel at least and get established there. I think we'll see something regarding Sam's storyline because they're not just going to leave that hanging. Well, they could. But I don't think they'll leave that hanging with this much time in the show. At least show us a scene of him getting there and establishing what his plan is going to be. Is he going to stay there, become a maester with his dad on his tail, or does he now not even go to the Citadel? Right? So I think he still goes to the Citadel. They have to bring that in a little bit because he's going to learn something that's going to be a key for everybody to survive this, I think.
Remember when you were telling me about the maesters with the rings?
Yeah, the different links of chain.
And it was like different experiences they had and things they learned and knew.
Each chain represents an area of study. So, for example, Valyrian steel is the link of the higher arts or magic. And you learn, you know, whatever you learn there. Although they in the books and even the show, Maester Luwin says that, you know, that shit doesn't work anymore. But you still study it, and I get this Valyrian link for it. And not very many, you know, maesters get this link. Then you have a link for ravenry and a link for healing and all that stuff. So
because Sam's got some serious on-the-job training.
That's right.
You know,
that's
he's right. Been north of the wall and seen all this.
Killed a White
stuff.
Walker
yeah.
with Dragonglass. Not many people can say that.
I think he'd be a great maester.
We've only seen three White Walkers die, and that was Sam, John, and now Mira with the Dragonglass spear.
Man.
And John used Valyrian steel. So, yeah, and that's another debatable thing. Like, is he going to become a maester, or is he just going to study areas he needs for the War for the Dawn? How much time does he have to earn these links, you know, yeah. in order to go be the Night's Watch Maester? Although I don't think he'll end up there now, since John's gone and the Night's Watch is basically, what, 20 people left? I mean, it looks the way it looks in the show.
Mm-hmm.
So, yeah, it's hard to say, but I think they'll establish that a little bit. Because in the books, there's a lot more going on at the Citadel. There's a few characters I wish we would see in the show. One named Marwyn the Mage. He is a believer in magic. And he's going over to find Danny, another person going to find her.
Mm-hmm.
And he basically thinks that there's this big maester conspiracy to rid the world of magic. I won't get into that too much here, but there's two sides of that. Yeah, he believes there's something going on with the other maesters and arts maesters trying to say they're trying to get rid of magic and they're anti-magic, anti-dragon, you know, anything magical. But at the same time, they still study magic and give out Valyrian steel links. So.
Jot that down and make a video after this season's over.
I may do it.
That would be cool.
People have asked me about that before. There's several different conspiracy style videos that people have asked for. The Great Northern's conspiracy, the Maester conspiracy, the Great Dornish plan.
Do that little series.
So
man.
Yeah, there's a lot of stuff, good stuff there.
Lastly, I'll just say, you said he's going looking for Danny. She's not too hard to find anymore.
No. She's
by God.
Follow the burn things.
Son of a bitch.
Yeah, I mean her story is now becoming known.
Yes.
So especially after this episode.
Yeah, she's just not whispers about some little girl.
Right. It's
the
not
scene.
It's not a little girl with baby dragons anymore who they thought would die as soon as they got as big as cats.
Yeah. Next question. Irina Stepien. Q&A. Where is the ghost?
Yeah, I don't know. It makes no sense to me why you have this epic battle. You have three dragons. You have one. You have all the CGI that it took to do these two big battles.
Mm-hmm.
Insane, and you don't have Ghost in the show. He's been missing for three or four episodes now since John came back, really, I think. So, I mean, I don't know why they didn't put him in there. I can only think it would be... Like, Rob apparently used Grey Wind in battle. And, you know, there were rumors that he could turn into a wolf in battle, which kind of hinted at his warging, because in the books he does. We just never get to really see it like we do John and Bran. But I think they left Ghost out because, realistically, if you have a wolf in a battlefield situation, he's probably going to die.
Exactly.
So I think they probably just left him out just because where do you fit a wolf in? What, you know what I'm saying? He runs in and takes out a few people.
He saves somebody one time.
Right, and he's probably done. Because, he, you know, he can take out a small group of people for sure. I mean, that happens in the books, but not a battle like that. So
hell no.
I would actually not, I'd rather not see him and let just assume he's off hunting somewhere, or he left him locked in a cage or whatever to
it
keep
him.
It was
more poetic for Jackass's hounds to eat him.
Right.
Then it would have been for Ghost to
yeah,
kill him, right.
I mean, a lot of people wanted to see Ghost, you know, rip Ramsey's throat out.
Ramsey,
but it was poetic justice for his own hounds to eat him, especially after him hunting people like animals.
I've yet to see that.
Yeah, you'll see that. And of course we saw Fat Walda and his half baby brother get ripped apart by his hounds.
God.
And we didn't get to see that on camera. They did give us the satisfaction of getting a face bite.
Damn right they did.
In this episode.
Very graphic. And he said he'd been starving them intentionally for 7
right.
days.
Right, so Ramsey is now dog shit.
He is.
Literally.
All right. This question is from Zachary Walton. Do you think Loras will confess to the Tyrells' involvement in Joffrey's death? That will totally set Cersei off to a wildfire level.
I think it's possible, but I don't know if he knows that they were involved. And this is a part you hadn't got to yet, but
no.
I think Lady Olenna, the Queen of Thorns.
You know I'd be talking about it if I'd gotten to Joffrey's death.
Right, exactly. So, yeah, I don't know if he knows all that as far as the details. I think her and Littlefinger probably the only ones that are aware of that. And,
okay.
Of course, a couple people they used in it getting done. So, I mean, it's possible, but I just don't know if he knows that at all.
Well, she's almost at a wildfire level now. What do you
she's already, I think she's already almost in that corner because, you know, she specifically, after the last episode, we saw Tommen give the decree that would mean no more trial by combat. That was her option. That was her way out. And she even told Jaime that, you know, you go to River Run, lead our army. I'm here. I got a trial by combat. I have the mountain.
She really had no worries at that point.
Right. That was her ace in the hole. And I think that now that that's taken away, that's when, you know, she had the scene with Qyburn and she said, you know, are those old rumors true? Are they just rumors or something to it? And of course, he's referring to the Mad King's wildfire stashes, which are all around the city and never found, specifically under the Sept of Baelor, where the trial will likely be. So, yeah, I think she's in that. I think that's her plan now, is to kill the High Sparrow and all that. Tommen may be a casualty in that. Whether it's on purpose or not, we don't know. But, you know, I think that's her plan now. So I don't think it'll take Loras to convict her of anything. I don't even know if she'll actually have a trial. You know, I don't know if we'll even get to the point where she has a trial.
Man.
I think we'll see Loras' trial start. And maybe, you know, that whole thing go down. But she's not going to be in that room if she's planning on setting it off. So,
cool. Do you think she's going to set it off?
I think she does. I mean,
built it up a lot.
Yeah, I mean, it's been so much, you know, so many hints at it. You know, I just think you're going to see it at least attempted. But then again, like I said in the preview video, if what I think is going to happen as far as Jaime ended up killing her at some point, then I don't know. Maybe she doesn't yet. Because he's still in River Run, as far as I know, and as far as the trailer or the teaser for next week. So then again, I could be completely wrong, and he doesn't have to be there. Maybe this is going to go further than we thought, because apparently, you know, we've heard. I try to stay away from, you know, news and all that stuff, because I want my predictions to be based off the show and the books or whatever.
Yes.
But I run across some people
it's
send me
hard
things.
Not to. It's hard to
right.
miss.
And I was just, when I released that little preview video after doing it late night and just putting it out there, then I started to see the salary negotiations.
Yeah.
So a lot of people thought that Cersei may die in episode 10, and I didn't think she would die quite yet. I think, you know, she would go for the wildfire and Jaime would be there and we'd be left wondering, and maybe that would happen in season 7 as far as him stopping the Mad Queen theory that I've been talking about. But now if he's still in River Run and she sets it off, well, then he's not there to stop it or whatever, so it's hard to say. It looks like she's going to be around maybe through season 8, so.
Well, based on what I saw at that Blackwater Bay, is that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
Right.
With what Tyrion did with that wildfire.
Yes.
If that shit got ignited under that castle, there'd be a crater left in the ground.
It damn right. Damn right.
I mean,
and that's what's crazy about it. That's been apparently there for over 14 years and never been found, all these caches. And all those lanterns and shit and all the fire in there, nothing's ever sparked it.
So, that just gave me chills. No shit, they're walking through there with torches
That's, they
I
have
got chills on my legs. That's...
No electricity, and it's just sitting there somewhere in caches.
Oh, my God.
And apparently, we don't really know exactly where. It was just mentioned, you know, in King's Landing, the Red Keep, the Sept of Baelor. So it's stashed everywhere. We just don't know where. And all it would take is a spark, and some people speculate it could be when Danny shows up and dragons ignite it. But obviously, it's been pointing in Cersei's direction for a long time now.
So. Man, I hated that. It made me actually think about napalm.
That's a horrible death. Yeah, it's basically what it is. It's nasty stuff.
Okay, next question. This is a long one,
all right.
But I'm gonna read a long one because she mentions my name. This question's from Dana Ristic. It says, "Hey Chris and James, one, love your vids.
Thank you.
Number two, Q&A question. I know I'm hoping for much again." But I just read the synopsis for the season finale, which says Brienne will meet an old friend turned foe. Since Catelyn is oddly being mentioned so many times during this one particular season, we saw the Tully residents get taken over, and Brienne, Jaime, and the Brotherhood are all in the Riverlands. Do you think Lady Stoneheart might finally appear, or am I just clinging to my hope that Brienne will follow her book arc? Then again, it is the longest episode in the show's history. Thanks.
Yeah, I still stick by what I've been saying. I think it's just too late for Lady Stoneheart. I mean, as far as, you know, where we are in the books. And, I mean, potentially it's still possible. But I think, you know, like the whole Jon Snow resurrection, it was the worst kept secret in TV history. We all knew it was going to happen. They kept trying to say, no, you know, Jon Snow's dead. But, yeah, we know he's dead. But that doesn't mean he can't be resurrected. Ooh. So I think we would know if Michelle Fairley was, if it would be the same actress. Now, they could use a different actress because she would look a lot different. But
can you give me a little rundown on Lady Stoneheart, please?
Yeah, basically.
Evidently, she's a popular character in the book.
She is. Because it was a stunner. It was one of those twists you didn't see coming. So Catelyn gets killed at the Red Wedding.
Okay.
They throw her body in a river. And 3 days later, the Brotherhood Without Banners, which is Beric and Thoros of Myr and those guys, mm-hmm. find her, and Beric gives her the quote-unquote kiss of life, which gives his life for hers. So he then dies.
Okay.
And she becomes the leader of the Brotherhood Without Banners. Now, of course, they're all about justice and all that stuff, kind of the Robin Hood style of justice.
Yeah.
But they're not evil people, which goes back to what we were talking about in the previous episode with the village slaughter. You know, they become a different type of group under her leadership. She's all about revenge. It's just vengeance on the Freys. Anybody that's talked to the Freys, anybody related to the Red Wedding, she just hangs them.
Damn.
And they did kind of shout her out a little bit with the hangings in the show.
Yeah.
So I think that's all it was. And then we saw the Hound literally piss in the river. Okay. And that's where they pulled her from. So I think that was them kind of saying it's not going to happen. I just think... You know, yeah, we have to, you know...
That makes sense now.
Right. We have to suspend disbelief a lot for these type of shows, or any show, really. But it's been years now since she died. And we have no idea what happened to her body, you know. And it would have to go back now and explain, okay, she was found a few days later. Because otherwise, she's just bone somewhere.
Right.
And we don't know what happened with that. So we did have to go back and explain, right after the Red Wedding, they threw her in the river or somewhere, and somebody came across her, and she's been doing this ever since. But Beric's still alive. Obviously, we just saw him, and now they're headed up north with the Hound, apparently, or wherever they end up, so I just don't see it happening.
By them combining Benjen and Cold Hands.
Cold Hands, right.
Benjen and Cold Hands, it makes people think outside the box a lot, don't it? And think
right.
characters can be combined.
Yeah,
to make...
and there's been some speculation that perhaps, you know, that the Blackfish could be a Stoneheart character. We talked about that last week a little bit.
That's right.
Like he could be, he
That's
just got killed.
Yep.
And then somebody could find him and make him, and he would take
Who's
that
Who's going to give him
a kiss? Right. But I don't think the Blackfish is that important to the story. They've, you know, cut a lot of stuff down, obviously, for the show again. So I think he's just gone. I don't think they would make a male character a female character in the books.
Gotcha.
So I think that's probably out of the question. I just think it's too late for a Stoneheart character. And honestly, for me, that wasn't my favorite character anyway. It was just a little twist there to get a little bit of vengeance for the Red Wedding on people that had wronged the Starks. My whole thing was with her is she wronged the Starks.
Damn right.
She started all this shit anyway. I told you before in a previous Q&A, I've never really liked Catelyn. I didn't hate her.
Right.
I never really liked Catelyn in the show or the books because she hated Jon. At least in the show, she did mention that she regretted not loving Jon and stuff like that coming up. She didn't give that shout out in the books that I remember. But I never really liked her. And then it just... So I never really cared for the Stoneheart as much as other people did. I mean, it's a popular character. It's a big twist. But I, just because I personally didn't like that character when she was alive and normal.
Why would you know, like
it? But she did more harm to the Starks than anybody.
I totally agree from because, what I've seen.
But everything was set off. And you could go back and say there was other things that led up to that Littlefinger tried to set up. But that wasn't a guarantee. His plans wasn't guaranteed to result in Catelyn taking Tyrion. With really no evidence other than a fucking knife that used to belong to him. So if she started the whole fucking thing... She got Ned stabbed and killed.
She goes behind Rob's back and does things.
And lets Jaime Lannister go. And I can understand that to a degree, trying to get her daughters back. And that was the right thing
to him about it.
Right. So the whole thing with Tyrion started all this. I mean, you can really point back to that as the beginning of everything. Yes, you would have still had Bran pushed out the window. And, you know, things would have went down differently. But the Lannisters would have never turned on Ned and the Starks if that didn't happen and they took Tyrion. Because even though Tywin hates Tyrion as his son, he's all about the family.
He would have came.
He had to raise his army because his son, a Lannister, was being held hostage.
Yes.
So that led to that anyway. So I never liked her. I really did.
She knew that was going to spark that. As soon as word got out that she had him.
Right.
It wasn't just
and then
get at Cersei and them. She knew that Tywin would get fired up about it.
Exactly. The ravens went out and everybody knew instantly that the imp's been taken, and of course Tywin has to immediately, for the family name, raise his army and go after, and there that created the whole damn thing. So cool.
Well, thanks for doing that, man. Yeah. I appreciate it. Next question, Janine Curtis. Q&A, are we gonna see some Frey pie? Do you think D&D will go in a different direction and give the Freys their comeuppance in a different way? Is Jaime going to betray them?
I would say I would probably, if I had to guess, just based off, again, the show, we haven't seen the setup with the Manderleys and all the whole thing for Frey Pie. I would love to see that. It would be awesome. But I think there was probably more of a possibility, if I had to choose from those two, that Jaime would betray them. I mean, right now, you know, right after we saw Riverrun get taken back, he did that for the Freys because he was doing his duty as a Lannister and for his king, his son.
Mm-hmm.
So I don't see right at this moment why he would betray the Freys all of a sudden, unless he just has this big change of heart and realize that everything they've done was wrong and he wants to get revenge for the Starks for some reason. So something would have to kick that off for him to say, you know what, I need to get behind the Starks. But at the same time, if he did that, he would be betraying Cersei and his king and all that stuff as far as the whole anti-Stark thing. So I don't see him doing that for no reason. You know, I think so something would have to happen for him to turn his back on Cersei and on Tommen and his house, essentially, Lannister. So in the books, he's already kind of at that point where that could happen because he knows about Cersei and all her extramarital affairs.
Yeah.
And he's aware of all these people that she's screwed. So it makes more sense there, but on the show, you just saw, I still love Cersei, I'm going to do whatever I can to get back to her. Now, he was more of an asshole, Jaime, to Edmure to save lives, so he realized that. She's still got the more honorable Jaime that we've been learning to like a lot better in the last few seasons. Something's got to happen for him to all of a sudden snap and just all of a sudden turn on the Freys, if that makes any sense. I mean, right now, he just took River Run. He did it. They put the Frey flags back up. Why now all of a sudden turn at the last minute?
True.
So something has to happen for that. Cool. I believe.
Next question. 20-sided Turtle says, Chris, do you think there's a chance that D&D hold off on the Tower of Joy reveal to let George R.R. Martin reveal it in the next book?
It's certainly a possibility. I mean, but I definitely think that we're going to see Bran in Vision stuff in episode 10. And I do know that middle Ned, or the younger Ned, is supposed to play a part in that. And so we're going to see the Tower of Joy, part 2. So I just don't see them doing a part 3. Because you would have to say, like, once he goes in there, it shouldn't be that much information.
Right.
He goes in there, he sees his dad, Ned, you know, laying down with Lyanna on her bed of blood, and she's saying, "Promise me, Ned," and there should be a baby. Really, that's all we need to see, and maybe them, their dialogue as far as the baby's name, or something to that effect. So I can't see them doing a whole Tower of Joy thing and not actually revealing it. That's the only reason I think. It would be a great cliffhanger, obviously, for TV purposes, because you see a baby, but maybe there's no hair, and you can't tell the color of the hair or whatever, and they could still be a question, oh, maybe it's Danny, or maybe it's twins or whatever. But I don't see them doing a Tower of Joy and not revealing it, because you would have to do a third part.
But shouldn't he see Rhaegar in there?
Rhaegar's not there. No, Rhaegar's dead at this point. So he went off to battle. Robert,
he died before the baby was born?
Yeah, he died in battle with Robert at the Trident before this happened. Damn. So she was there with the king, but he had his Kingsguard there. That's why they were there. They wasn't there.
Ned was just there to protect her.
Ned showed up to find her. The Kingsguard are already there to protect her, and that's one of the things that makes it such a big deal about who the baby was, because why would he have Kingsguard guarding some random tower in Dorne?
Right.
And just some random woman that he just loved or whatever, without there being a prince involved. Or a princess, but a prince involved.
And it was Ned's sister, correct?
Right, Lyanna. Okay. So, I think they could do it in a way where we learn the truth, but John doesn't learn the truth, or something to that effect, for a cliffhanger style type ending, I guess. But I just don't see them doing a part 3 is the only reason I think that. You know what I mean? Why would you go to a Tower of Joy again?
I agree.
Where he goes alone now, because obviously Blood Raven's gone.
Yeah.
He goes in there alone. He walks in there and then still doesn't find out. So it makes no sense for them to do a Tower of Joy part 3 in season 7.
So you're saying Bran walks in into the Tower of Joy,
right,
and should see Ned and Lyanna, and that's it?
You should see Ned and Lyanna and possibly Wyla the Wet Nurse. We don't know if they're going to put that in the show or whatever.
And then a baby, and he's going to know what's going on, and he's either going to spill his guts or it's going to wait till the next season.
You're right, yeah. And then that's the thing that right there. I mean, I just don't know how much time they're going to have wherever he is and has this vision.
True.
We don't. I guess he's still north of the wall. Maybe we see him come beyond the wall, come south first, and however he connects to werewood.net now, whether it's through his sled or he can just do it now, or if he actually needs a tree, we don't know.
Through his sled.
It's his werewood sled, right? Maybe he can just touch dead wood. I don't know. So, yeah, I mean, depending on how much time and the time in the order they do it in the show, perhaps they do it first, and then later on we see another piece of it in the same show where he goes to try to contact John for some reason. Maybe Hallen Reed shows up somewhere in real life, because we got to see him again to confirm that kind of stuff. So I think we'll see Hallen Reed, not necessarily this season, but we will see him, I think, in the show. We're definitely going to see him in the books. So, I mean, I just don't see why they would do a Tower of Joy part 2 and not reveal that and have to do a part 3. Because we do know that middle Ned or young Ned's going to be in this show.
Cool.
So,
all right, our next question comes from Tom Snow. It says, 1-1 was the last giant left in the world, right?
I believe in the show he is. We saw 3 total and all 3 died now. So I believe they're insinuating they're gone. Also, the Children of the Forest, we all saw them die. And we don't know if we're going to see them in the God's Eye, if there's still some left, but it implied that that was the last of the races, which were the 2 original races to inhabit Westeros. So.
Oh, really?
Yeah, so they're all apparently gone, at least in the show.
Well, I know that disappointed you that he didn't have a weapon or
something. It's plot, you know. I mean, but you give him a damn tree or just a big shield, and he's unstoppable.
He really would have been. In that episode, he could have plowed over a bunch of horses.
He knocked horses left and right. I mean, he could have. It's like we saw him at Hardhome. They thought about it then, right? At Hardhome, he picks up a big post. It was part of the big hut they were in, and it's on fire on one end. And he's swinging it around, knocking wipes around.
I saw somebody comment that.
Yeah, I mean, they did that before. So why would he just charge a bunch of, I mean, you know, over time, but enough arrows and stuff will kill him. Yeah. And in previous season, when their other giants died, they had weapons. They had huge bow and arrows, and they could reach the top of the wall where the men couldn't.
Wow.
Because the men were trying to, the wildlings were like, pew, and it was like just, you know, wouldn't even come close to the guys on top of the wall.
No, but
one of the giants killed somebody with their giant-ass bow, and it went through him and shot him up through the air like a damn slingshot. So,
damn it.
And he came crashing down on the other side of the wall in Castle Black in the middle of a battle. So, yeah. I mean, give one a bow. I mean, let him make a bow or fucking grab a tree or something. He can just go swinging around like a damn Louisville slugger, like I said. Shit.
That was really sad when he, you know, had all those arrows in here.
Yeah, he looked like a pincushion. I mean, I know a lot of people said that, but that's exactly what you thought about.
And John looked at him, and I thought he missed an opportunity to say something. He should have, I think, vocalized what he was thinking.
Yeah, but he don't speak the common tongue. He was thinking, you could tell that look, though. He was like looking over him like, you know, I support you. I did my job. I'm dying for you here. And John reached out to him, and then they had to, this is another nitpicky thing I thought was stupid. They had to give Ramsey one last win to have the kill shot on 1-1. Why would he kill 1-1 when he's already dying and not kill Jon Snow?
While Jon's looking at 1-1?
Jon's just standing there and he shoots 1-1.
I didn't even think about that.
You know what I mean? So, you know, it was just for effect, but, you know, to give him the last little victory to kill a beloved character. But you kill Jon and you damn near win. I mean, you're still going to lose.
Yeah.
But, you know, you knock out the bastard. It was Bastard Bowl after all. So, yeah, I mean, I hate it. I liked 1-1. He was cool as hell. And, but that's part of this story of...
If Jon winds up running something at the end of all this, whether he's King of the North or whatever happens.
Right.
I think he should build a statue.
I agree. I think because, you know, this, the whole thing is about is how all this damn warfare wipes people out.
Yeah.
And now you have the two original races
gone
completely, apparently.
Yeah.
And it was all man's fault and whatever. So that's the whole idea anyway of, you know, this. It is an anti-war show shown in a very gruesome way.
Yeah, it really is, ain't it? Next question from Lance Kozak. It says, Q&A, James, can you please wear a matching tie-dye bandana the next time? It really upped the entertainment value of an already great episode.
That would be awesome.
They don't make bandanas big enough to fit this big tater head I got.
Oh, we can do something. We'll get a towel and tie-dye or something.
Hell yeah, I'll do
it. Old t-shirt. Another t-shirt. Yeah, you could do that.
I'll do it. I'll look like...
And you can go, West Side, you know, or would it wear it backwards. That'd be cool. Yeah, let's do that. That'd be cool.
Lance really does have another question for you.
Okay.
It says, now that the Hound is running with Brotherhood Without Banners again, it's probably likely that he'll run into Lady Brienne again. You think that might be a slightly awkward reunion?
I would say so. Yeah, that would be awkward. Although she's headed back north, and they're now headed north, so I'm thinking they probably would meet again. But he is kind of changed. Violence was not his first option. You know, he tried to escape it, but he just went on this little short little tear of vengeance.
Yeah.
So I mean, he is kind of a different person though, because he sat down and have a normal conversation with Thoros and Beric. So. Yeah, I mean, I think it'd be awkward, but I don't think they'll fight again or anything like that. So I think it'd be kind of cool for him to meet the woman that knocked his block off. You know what I mean?
No, I don't.
Yeah, well, you will.
Awesome.
You will. That's right. That's right. You hadn't seen that. So.
D. DeBelly says, how will Daenerys stop the Dothraki to rape? I guess from raping. With plot magic, it says.
Yeah, I mean, that's, again, it goes back to the whole cultural thing. You know, she's saying, all right, you've been doing this for thousands of years, no more. But then again, you know, the way I can justify it, I guess, because you really can't, she can't control all that. She's not in the battlefield. If she's up on a dragon flying around, she can't see what they're doing.
Yeah.
And babysit everybody. So you just have to kind of use imagination and say, you know what, they saw a fucking dragon, which they didn't believe existed.
Right.
And they just truly worship her because she walked out of that fire unburnt, so they believe she is a goddess, so to speak. So they just listen. Yeah. I mean, that's what you kind of got to believe. So it is kind of plot magic in that sense.
I do believe that the Iron Islands, I think they'll listen just because of the deal they made, right?
Well, yeah, that's what we were talking about before. And, will they listen?
But you know, these people, they're kind of wilder.
Right. You know? Well, yeah.
I do believe, though.
There's not much different in their cultures other than slavery, though. You know?
Really?
I mean, if you think about it, they're just kind of the sea version, right?
Of okay.
But they don't take slaves.
That's a good way to look at
right,
it.
Right. They don't take slaves or anything like the Dothraki do, but they still pillage and rape and plunder, and that's how they get their stuff. You know, they don't. That's why they're so drab looking,
yeah,
as far as their armor and stuff, because it's the Ironborn way to take whatever you get, but you don't wear fancy gold and all that shit.
Yeah, I saw that episode where
when Theon goes and sees his father
the
first
time. Take the cape off.
Take that shit off. You look like a damn.
If you bought it, take it off.
Yeah. What price did you pay for it?
Right.
Did you pay the gold price? Did you pay the iron price? So yeah, that's true. You can't. It is kind of plot magic if that's going to happen. But then again, that begs the question. Is she going to be able to change the Dothraki way and the Ironborn way, for that matter, after they go across, perhaps, and win the Seven Kingdoms or whatever? We know we're all going to focus on the main thing coming, the War for the Dawn with the White Walkers and all that, but as little subplots are still around before we get to that point where nothing else really matters, will Yara hold up her end of the deal? So,
well, before we wrap this up this week, I want to kind of give you a chance to maybe let these people know that you know what white ravens. I saw this one guy going off on you, and you clearly said in your video.
Yeah. I mean, I may have not made it as clear as it should have been. I mean, I went in there late night thinking, okay, let me just do this thing real quick before I go to bed, and just did a voiceover. First time I've ever done a video not on camera, by the way.
Right.
And
I
so
liked it.
People were asking, "Are you okay? You sounded sick." It was late, and I was really close to the mic because, you know, normally it's, you know, 2 or 3 feet away from me when I'm on camera. So anyway, yeah, I mean, I thought I explained the part right after, because I just speculated. It was just pure speculation, just
sure,
ideas, that the White Raven could be brand warging something, because they do represent important things from the Citadel. The Citadel has sent out ravens, White Ravens only. They don't really carry a message, so to speak, other than it being a White Raven is the message.
Oh.
And it means a change of seasons. So we've already saw in the show when basically Pycelle, the way he words it is, you know, the days are getting shorter. Here's the White Raven from the Citadel. Summer is over. So then it didn't really say it's the beginning of fall. You know what I mean? So there is a fall. People think there's just summer and winter. But there is a spring and a fall in between those times. And there was a year of the fall spring where they thought it was going to be summer again, but it was just a short snap of warmth, I guess, or whatever it's mentioned in the books as far as some history goes. So in A Dance with Dragons, in the epilogue, they do send out another White Raven saying winter is here. I was just kind of thinking, when I was thinking about the whole brand thing or whatever, I mean, I thought I did explain that these usually do come from the Citadel.
You showed a clip.
And I even showed the clip,
yeah,
with the White Raven in the cage saying this was the end of summer. But I was just thinking maybe the show don't want to complicate things, because they do keep it simple, and send out another one, which is almost the same message. Because if they really don't mention spring and autumn, right, in the show, they only mention summer and winter, and you've already seen a raven come out and say it's the end of summer, it's almost the same message at the beginning of winter for show watchers.
Yeah.
If that makes any sense.
No, it does.
So I was just thinking, why on the show would they send out another one? I mean, that's likely what it is. It's probably just and it is named, as far as the 10th episode, it is named The Winds of Winter. So it's simply a raven from the Citadel saying winter is here. But again, I was just saying, why send out an end of summer message on the show and then years later send out a winter's here message, which is basically the same thing, the way they portrayed it.
And so with that logic, you said, what else could it be?
What else could it be?
Possibly.
Could it be Bran sending, you know, warning? Because there's still, you know, it's said that the Citadel breeds these White Ravens themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So that it's not like a natural species. So,
okay.
But we don't really know that. You know, there could be another white owl out. I mean, you know, couldn't tell if it was a raven or not.
Right.
So,
right.
I mean, it could have been, you had the white falcon that Littlefinger gave to Sweet Robin.
Hmm.
So, I mean, I was just throwing out ideas. If it's not this simple, mm-hmm, explanation, which is the Citadel, which likely it is, and I believe it is, and it was just throwing ideas out there. Could it be Bran, you know, with an important message for Jon after the Tower of Joy? Could it be from Sam? he is in the Citadel, he finds out something maybe. What if he gets like established as a maester and then has to send a really important message to John or something like that? So it's just speculation. I mean, that's all it was. But I thought I clearly communicated that that was normally sent out only by the Citadel in the books. Because they do send out two in the books, I was just saying. If that, hopefully that's cleared up. Because I saw a lot of comments, and most were fine. Most are just like, I think the White Raven is just from the Citadel saying winter's here. The episode's called, you know, The Winds of Winter, and I agree with that completely. I mean, most people just said that as a general reminder, I guess, if that wasn't clear enough.
All right, well, you know, most of these questions are pretty repetitive from here on out.
Yeah, I mean, there wasn't a lot in this episode. You had two big battles. You had the Battle of Fire, had the Battle of Ice, simultaneous. They had the rebirth scenes, I think. I pointed that out in the review about John coming out of the pile, something made him claw his way back up and try to live and take that breath, and then it goes back to the scene and Danny, you know, frees the slaves and comes out of that crowd when they're calling her Misa.
And it was very similar.
Very similar shots. That was definitely a purposeful thing. So there's a lot of stuff to kind of wrap up for the season, but there's also potential cliffhangers too. So I think it's going to be great. I mean, I think they've had a few slow ones in a row, which, you know, that's fine. You have, you know, it's a roller coaster ride. So I think it's going to be a damn big episode. And the thing is Sunday ends and we're all waiting another year, because you wait that long and it's over like that. And then you're waiting again and speculating again.
Well, do you care if I give a shameless plug?
No, I'll go for it.
I see a lot of you guys coming over to my channel and I appreciate that. And I, you know, just want to let you know that with Chris's help, you know, I've done a Facebook page too, where I actually do daily trivia. So if you like just a little shot of sports trivia each day, just check me out. I appreciate everything you guys do for me, and a lot of personal questions have been asked, and I appreciate that too. Take care, guys.
And that will do it for us this week on this episode 9 Q&A and episode 10 speculation. So let us know what you think in the comments below. What are we going to see Sunday? Are we going to see Sam at the Citadel? Are we going to see the RLJ reveal? What kind of cliffhangers? Is King's Landing going to burn? Obviously, I think we know that Cersei's going to live, at least for another season or two. So, anyway, let us know what you think in the comments below. As always, thank you for all the support, especially you guys on Patreon. Really appreciate it. Thanks for watching, you guys, and we'll see you next time.